Hey, everybody. Welcome to the next episode of How to Make a Movie When You Don't Know Shit. And today's guest is my friend, Mario. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great. Thank you. I'm trying to see. I have something here in the middle. It says this meeting being recorded. Continue.
Yeah. That's all. Just hit continue.
Let me press that. Perfect. Perfect.
Great. Very good perfect. To see you. It's been a long time.
It has. It really... It's been a real long time. I think it was 2013, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. So 2013 is when we made the film. But did you come to any of the premieres or anything? Because we did a premiere in New York, right? In 2014 in New York, that one?
That is correct.
So that was probably the last time I saw you.
Wow.
Yeah, wow. So 2014 in the premiere in New York that we did, which was very exciting.
It was. It really was. It was amazing.
Was that the first time you saw it on the big screen?
I believe I did see it at the Seattle. I believe. I'm sure I saw it at Seattle Film Fest.
Yeah, that's right. You came to that as well.
I did.
It was quite a whirlwind, and I want to go back a little bit for the listeners and just tell the whole story. But yeah, I think that was the last time. Did you come to Holly Shorts in LA when we filmed it there? Okay, but the Seattle Film Festival was quite an experience because we were treated like celebrities there. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, it was great. It was a great experience. It truly was.
It was
amazing.
It was a great town and the people there were so nice to us. And Seattle's just a really cool place.
Definitely is.
So take me all the way back. So you, this podcast to me is, it's just all about Dave and Dave's creation of this film. And so I know that you go way back with Dave. So kind of tell me like how you guys met, what the experience was, and then we'll go all the way up to the point at which you got involved in the movie.
Yeah. My heart goes out to Dave and his entire family. For me, he was a wonderful guy inside and out.
Yeah.
I was fortunate for Dave to meet my dad, and I know he was close to his dad. So we had this similar approach to fathers, and he was great. We go back to, I would say, 1993.
Okay. How'd you meet?
We met while he was doing his first film, I believe, was Push.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a great movie also.
Great movie.
Fortunate to go to the premiere, which I saw, Dave direct and Chaz Palminteri. And I knew right there and then, as being a guest and watching his film, I knew that one day, maybe, just maybe, we could work together, you know, because that was my dream of always becoming an actor myself, you know.
Oh, I didn't know that. So you grew up in New York?
I did. I grew up in, I was born in Brooklyn.
Okay.
Bushwick, Wyckoff Hospital.
Okay.
I grew up in Ridgewood.
Okay.
And had a small deli in Middle Village.
I know that very well.
Yeah. And I was fortunate enough to be around different type of people. Growing up in Brooklyn, you know, you go down a few blocks down and it would be mostly Latino.
Mm-hmm.
And you go up a few blocks up and it would be Italian. I was able to convert myself to a Latino neighborhood and to an Italian neighborhood, which I believe in the long run I benefited from. You know?
Sure. And when you say you had aspirations to act, did you do anything in school? Did you pursue it at all before?
I did pursue it. You know, I did take a few courses. I went to HB Studios.
So did I.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, that's the best one in New York. I love HB.
I would sneak out of my deli and take a few courses out there. I couldn't do it as much as I really wanted to because It was a family-run business. Mm-hmm. And I guess they wanted my presence there at the same time. Yeah.
So, they're like, where are you? You're like, I'm in acting class. They're like, when did you cut the gabagool? Where are you?
Right.
But you're very authentic. You're just, everything about you is just very, very authentic. And you were such a great addition to the film. It was wonderful. So, okay. So then you have this family run deli in Middle Village, and Dave, you become friends with Dave. You go to see Dave's premiere, and in the back of your mind, when you're seeing this premiere, you're like, one day I want to work with Dave. I want to be in a film, or just, you know, sort of got your mind going.
It did. It got my mind going. I was drawn into the movie itself. I thought the way it was filmed, and from the very beginning with the music and the way the movie started, Push, mm-hmm. I'm talking about.
Yeah.
It grabbed my attention. And I just said, you know, with Dave being so close to home, because we kind of knew each other, but really didn't, you know, I have a good friend of mine who went to military school, I believe, with Dave. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's how it was.
Okay.
And, that's it. I just believe in destiny, and we worked together. I was fortunate enough that he noticed me, and you know, I gave him everything that I could at that
time.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now with Once Upon a Time in Queens, you own the deli in Middle Village, and so when do you get the call from Dave that you're going to be involved, and do you know right off the bat that you're going to be in the movie, or did that come later? Like, what was the whole setup? Because we used your deli. It was, you know, it's where Michael worked. It was where all the neighborhood guys hung out.
Right.
I did a scene in the deli. I feel like everybody did a scene in the deli. Yeah.
It was like something I really did not expect. I mean, I've gone to auditions, and I expected a call back, which, many years, my first audition was 1993 with an open cast call for Night Falls in Manhattan. And I get to the front of the line. I waited 5 hours. Wow. As soon as I get to the line, boom, we stopped accepting, you know, calls.
Oh, wow.
So
heartbreaking.
And that movie was with Andy Garcia.
Mm-hmm.
He was Andy Garcia, and who else? Actually, James Gandolfini was in that movie.
Wow. Oh, okay. From The Sopranos.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Mm-hmm. So I figured, you know, everything is going to be hard for me in my life, which I'm used to. You know, it's, mm-hmm. it's great. This year came kind of easily in a way. You know, I was approached by a good friend of mine, Ignacio Panepinto.
Yeah.
Who does location at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So him being friends with David, he's like, Mario, listen, I have a little something here for you. Maybe it could work. Mm-hmm. We're looking to film a movie, and we want to use your deli. So I said, okay, it sounds really good to me. You could film. Mm-hmm.
Oh, right.
I love movies.
You love movies. You love film.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I do.
Yeah.
Something sounds that fun. I've had it in my heart for a very long time. I just didn't approach it the right way, I guess. You know, anyway.
Who knows, right?
Who knows, right?
Yeah.
And from there, I said yes, not knowing that I had any part of the movie.
Right. You were just offering up your location. Yeah.
Right. It just snowballed, and everything snowballed where I just kept going with it, you know? And at the same time, they used my deli, which I loved. And I was fortunate enough to have a scene, have a big part with an iconic star with Paul Sorvino, because as we all know, for me, he is the best at that, for sure. You know?
Yeah. I mean, it was such an iconic scene. And so...
Mr. Joe, do you support me?
Sono contento.
Prego. È pure un Mr. Joe, un'altra cosa. C'è pallore in giro, camorra. Ma questo ragazzo sta sa cantando.
Inteso.
Canta assai.
Vero.
Vero.
Bello saperlo. Bello saperlo.
you were so good and just so poised. I mean, it's just like you were just like meant to do this, you know? And you speak Italian to Paul, right? Is that the
That is correct.
Majority of the dialogue. And now, did Paul speak Italian? Did he already know, or you had to teach him, or how did that go?
No, I didn't have to teach Paul anything. I'm sweating bullets. It's 110 degrees here in New York.
And the humidity.
I don't think I have the air conditioner on. I have a fan blowing. I feel like it's the old days again, but yeah. I appreciate it. No, Paul, I didn't have to teach him anything. He was, he's true at everything. He's an amazing. He carried me through every step, which he promised me that he would.
Aw, that's so great.
Yeah, he worked with me. He worked with me.
He made me
better than what I was.
Oh, so great. And so now you know not only is your deli getting used in all these scenes, and you're there, you know what I mean? You're there watching the whole process, watching us do the scenes. I mean, I think the first scene that I shot, my first day of work, was in the deli where I'm coming in with Livia Pianopinto, and I'm bringing her in, and Michael picks her up and kisses her, and we're in your deli just doing all this stuff. And I don't forget, Michael and I often were on set, and Michael would go, let's not do lunch here. Let's go to Mario's deli and get sandwiches, because your food is so good at that deli.
Right.
That was all we wanted to do, was eat there. And so that was fun, too, because we all became kind of like friends, like family, really, working on this movie.
Absolutely. It was an amazing experience, just having Michael Rapaport. As I believe, if I'm not mistaken, which I'm not, because I don't always want to be. I'm very humbled, you know. Mm-hmm. I go about in a humbled way. Mm-hmm. He was portraying me in the deli.
Yeah.
You know, I remember at one time I had a green diesel watch. I'll never forget that watch that I had. I had actually bought that watch on my birthday. I bought it on my own for myself in Soho.
Yeah.
And he goes, Mario, listen, I'm playing you. So I want to know, where can I get this green watch you got? So I was like, take mine. So Mike, you know, he's like, no, I can't do that. Props is going to hook me up with one.
Yeah.
But it was amazing. I still can't believe the fact that he was playing me, you know?
Yeah.
It's crazy. It's insane, you know?
That's great. And I think you probably pulled a lot from hanging out with you, because I know you guys became close. You guys were buddies.
We did. Definitely. You know. Actually, went to St. John's with him. You know, he hung out. He showed me the basketball court. You know, the field where they play University in Queens.
Yeah.
Actually, my son Vincent went there today on a tour.
Of St. John's University.
It's crazy, right?
Thinking about going there.
Absolutely. Yeah. Wow. He likes it. Great campus, you know.
Isn't that interesting foreshadowing, right? Here you are with Michael Rapaport touring that, and now your son.
A year later, my son goes sees the field, you know, the basketball court and everything. It's insane how, you know, life operates, you know. It's crazy.
Yeah. And Michael was very, you know, you never know what to expect when you work with actors, and I've had good experiences and bad experience, but this movie was a really good experience because everybody was just cool. Everybody was humble. Everybody was cool. There was no attitude problems. You know, everyone was like, everyone had a passion to make this movie great. And I always say, I think that's a lot of credit to Dave and the way that Dave ran that set, you know, because he didn't tolerate any bullshit, but he was very open to hearing suggestions. And okay. So your scene, your iconic scene with Paul Sorvino, where you're speaking Italian, how does that go? You get the script from Dave. He's like, here's what you're going to say. I mean, did Dave write it in Italian? Did he know how to?
He wrote it in English. And I came up with a counterattack on saying, why don't we do it in Italian, in Sicilian?
Brilliant.
And Dave, the open mind that he had, which he gave me full control, is for me, it's what an actor wants with a great director, that he, he was, and for me, he still is, because I still feel his presence around me every day.
Yeah.
And he trusted me, you know, and yeah. I said it in Italian. And Paul Sorvino, Mr. Sorvino, was incredible. Counterattacked with everything. I would say something, and he had me beat. You know, he's amazing.
Yeah.
I was fortunate. I was really fortunate to be around such great people. It really was. Honestly, it's once in a lifetime opportunity, you know?
It was so, so great. And your scene with him, you know, it makes so much sense that it's in Italian because of, and I won't give away too much of the movie because I think people who haven't seen it need to go see it. But the context of the conversation that you're having with Paul Sorvino is it's of the nature that you wouldn't want everybody to know what you're talking about. So it's so brilliant and smart on your part to want to say it in Italian so that it's almost like this secret conversation that you guys have, which is great. Right. So tell me about that day. Cause I know like my first acting part in a big feature film was with, was in Casino with Sharon Stone, and the scene got cut, but I'll never forget that day because the butterflies that I had in my stomach and the nerves and the flop sweat, I was just so anxious because, you know, there's an aura. If you've never been around a famous person, right? There's an aura. You see them on the screen, you feel like you know them, but when they enter the room, there's something where you just feel like, oh wow, I'm in the presence of greatness, you know.
Right.
And Paul was that. So what was that day like for you?
Like I said, Paul, Mr. Sorvino, he made it so much easier for me to get into that zone with him, because he never carried that weight that he was this god of an actor. He came in there like I did, you know. He went to my level where he knew where I was at.
So
he made me feel comfortable, which was very important. Mr. Sorvino, for me, Paul, he made it easy. He made it really easy. He carried me through that whole scene. I have to give credit to where it's due. I'm just a kid coming out of nowhere where he's been around, and he's still doing a fantastic job at it.
So
it was easy for me in a sense that he carried me through it. He did. He really
That's
did.
That's great. That's he really great. Did. I mean, it's so nice to hear. It's so nice to hear. And the scene is so, it's one of my favorite scenes in the movie. It really is. You did a really good job. And I know you're a humble guy and I know you play it down, but you know, it's not easy what you did, you know, even with Paul carrying you, it's not easy what you did to come in and, you know, and it went smooth. I remember that. It was very smooth. That was a big day. That was a big, you know, with Johnny Roastbeef's funeral, and there was a lot of new people, and Michael and I had a lot of business, and then, you know, it was just a lot going on that day. So just to come in and have that big scene and have it go so well. So now tell me, because I talked about this with Larry. You remember Larry?
Of course.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So Larry and I talked to you, because Larry's kind of like you, you know, he'd never been around. You know, I mean, you had more exposure than Larry did because you had been around sets and Dave and Push and the premieres and all that. But Larry had no experience with any of that. So what Larry and I talked about, and I want to know if this happened to you too. It happened to me, and I think it happens to all actors or anybody involved in a movie. After the movie wraps and everybody leaves and goes back, because we shot it in 18 days, right? And then it was done, right?
Right.
Did you feel sort of like that transition, that letdown, sort of like that, you know, like when you get out of, like when you graduate high school and you're like, well, that's it, it's over. Like, you know what I mean? These people that I was hanging out with and, you know, sort of like at that rap party, it's like, what do we do now? You know, did you, what was that like for you after it was all over?
Well, when it was all over, actually up to this day now, I'm still thinking about the movie. You know, like the title says, you know, Once Upon a Time in Queens. And, and I put myself into that title, you know, Once Upon a Time in Queens. We were able to film a movie with such wonderful people, you know, fortunate to work with Dave, which is in my heart forever. Iconic people, you know, Paul Sorvino, you produced it. Your husband, Kevin. It just, we became all one so fast. And up to this day, I don't know, I lived my life like that, you know, like when you connect with people, I kind of keep them in my heart. You know? After I filmed that movie, I didn't think I was a star. You know, I remember going to Rayo's one night and I met Frank Pellegrino, which the owner of Rails, and I walked in there and he's like, hey, Mario, you're the actor. And I said, nah, I just couldn't see myself as the actor because I was so involved with the deli. And, you know, for me, an actor is like, you know, Paul Sorvino, Andy Garcia, Robert De Niro, Joe Pesci. For them, for me, Leonardo DiCaprio, for me, those are actors. You know, I'm just a guy who's trying to do something. I don't know what it is, but if it's acting, then let's say it's acting. You know, maybe one day I should accept it that that I am, you know.
I think that's really, when you're talking, the thing that sticks out for me is your love for it. And I think that's, you know, we have to do things in life that we love to do, you know what I mean? And I think you really love it, and you have a respect for it. And that is really special. You know, the respect you have for it, because, you know, I felt that, you know, when I grew up back East, I didn't know, not everybody I grew up with was an actor. So the fact that I wanted to be an actor was a special thing. You know, there were certain people that were pursuing it. When I got to LA, everybody was an actor. And it was like, it was kind of a letdown in a way. It was like, but you've never even studied. How could you call yourself an actor? Because I have what you have, which is a respect for it as a craft and an art. And, you know, it took a long time before I was ever like, oh yeah, I'm an actor. And even in that film, I felt like I kind of don't even belong here with these people. Like, these people are you know, just so amazing. And
they are. And, you know, and you know, I even you know, Chaz Palminteri, you know, there's another one. And I have a regret that I actually delivered breakfast to Chaz Palminteri while they were on set, and he was doing his piece, and I didn't want to go there and bother him at his work because I knew he was working on that scene.
Yeah.
Looking back now, because, you know, De Niro doesn't, he takes his acting very serious. He don't want, you know, I didn't want to bother the guy, you know what I mean? Right. But looking back, if I could have done something different, I would have gone there and delivered my breakfast. Instead of going back to work, I would have hung out there the whole day and hung out with Chaz Palminteri. That's a regret I do have.
And you would have been so welcome there, because that's the other thing too, is the set was that. It was very, we filmed it at Corey Rooney's house, and like, yeah, some of those memories are, and I felt really privileged too, because I talked a little bit about this on the other podcast, but I didn't think I was going to be a producer. I came just to act, you know, I just thought I was going to be in the movie, act, have my little part, and I probably would have went home. And then, you know, because my brother-in-law wound up financing it, my husband and I then became, you know, we started getting more involved in the project. Right. Protecting his investment, making sure things went a certain way and all that. I was very lucky in the fact that, you know, it's just what you said, Once Upon a Time in Queens, like I got to play a bigger game than I was, you know, prepared
that
to play.
Amazing.
And
it was amazing. Fantastic. You did fantastic.
It was amazing. Thank you. And it was just like getting to watch. That's the most special part of being a producer, is I sat at that monitor and saw, like, I'm like, I'm watching Chaz Palminteri and Paul Sorvino do a scene together.
Right.
Like, what? You know?
Fantastic. You know, it's once in a lifetime.
Once in a lifetime.
I'm watching Once Upon a Time in Queens, and I remember the opening of the movie, and like it would have everyone's name in it, and then you know, your name, of course, and then I see Mario Ruffo with the background of New York City, and then I see Anchez Palminteri. You know, I see all these little things, and for me, it's amazing for a guy who had a dream of once becoming an actor, and there he is. He's on the big screen. It's amazing.
Yeah. No. With those people, you know.
Right.
So after it was over, what do you do now? You go back to the deli, you go back to work,
I go back to the deli, but it's hard because, you know, you just finished filming a major film, and you're working with Paul Sorvino, and there's
friends, almost like friends with, you know, everybody. Yeah.
And you're in a deli, you're cutting bagels. Meanwhile, you're trying to keep your concentration on the business, but at the same time, you know, I still had this movie thing in me. It actually hit me harder, actually. Yeah, it's something that I definitely wanted to do, but it's hard.
That is a hard transition, because also too, like most of us, Dave, me, Renee, you know, a bunch of us all went back to LA.
Right.
So it was like we kind of infiltrated Queens, and there was so much going on. Every day there was so much going on.
It was.
And then sort of like it probably felt very kind of quiet, like
disappeared, now, very lonely. Yeah. I felt like I was in a desert, no longer
That could be a movie right there, like you going back to cutting bagels and making sandwiches and
They could have filmed a Once Upon a Time in what is that called by Tarantino? No, was it Tarantino? No,
Hollywood. Yeah, Once Upon a Time.
No,
in
but
Hollywood,
there was another movie. Tarantino. Once Upon a Time in
America.
Right, but there was another one.
There was another one.
It was a Western one.
Oh, I don't know that one. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. That was Quentin Tarantino.
No, that was actually a good movie. Totally.
That was great. Almost like Once Upon a Time in the Life of Mario Ruffo, who's back in the deli.
Upon a time, there was Mario. Yeah, but you know what? I'm still here. Listen, I look at it that I try to live my life, you know, living the moment and being grateful for everything. You know, where when you're younger, you know, you're snowballing through everything. Everything is going quickly, you know. As you get older, things go quicker.
Yeah. And you want to slow them down.
You want to slow them down a little bit.
Yeah.
But I enjoy that. You know, I watch it a lot, the movie Once Upon
That's
a
great.
Time.
That's great.
I don't tell
great.
Anyone. You know, I right. look at, but of course, I watch my scene a lot. I do.
Yeah.
Wasn't happy with it.
But just so you know, that's really normal. I watch certain things that I did and I cringe and I go, I wish I would have. I think, and there's a lot of actors. I forgot who I was listening to. You know, Frank Vincent, who is a family friend. He told me he never watches his performance. Incredible actor. And he told me he never watches his performance. He doesn't even like to watch the dailies. So a lot of actors can't watch themselves.
Right.
You know, so what you're experiencing of like, oh, I wish I could have done this different or better. That's really, really normal. So now tell me, because this is another fascinating area. So now tell me, when the film comes out, when people are like the premiere and all this stuff, I mean, there had to be friends and family of yours that have never seen this side to you that all of a sudden are watching you not only act, right? We all go see our friend in like community theater, but you're in a major motion picture with Paul Sorvino, acting your butt off. I mean, what was that like? Were people just like blown away?
Yeah, I think they were. You know, I was... you know, I was listening through the whispers and they, you know, you could felt, you know, there was like, I guess a lot of the people that did attend the movie, the festival, they knew that I had a strong love for it. And but they did. They were all excited for me, you know, great friends of mine that we go back many, many years. And it was an incredible event. I had my dad there, which.
Wow.
Yeah, I had my dad, you know, it was an amazing time. I remember you and your dad were sitting in front of us.
Special. Those are the real special parts.
It really is. I just wish I could have known what my dad was thinking at that time, you know?
Sure, he was so proud of you. He must have been so proud.
I tried to avoid all that, you know?
Yeah.
It was so dark in there.
Yeah.
It was an incredible feeling, you know?
That is an incredible feeling.
It is. I was so happy for everyone that was involved with that movie. I have to tell you the truth.
Yeah. I really think
it was more for everyone that worked on it. You know,
yeah.
I looked at it that way, you know, so like I never once looked at it that it was me, you know,
mm-hmm.
which was very important to me because that is just my character.
Mm-hmm.
But it was amazing. It was such a special thing.
You know, my aunt, I just lost my aunt. My aunt just passed away a couple of weeks ago. And
Thank you.
I appreciate that. And we picked her up in a limousine and she came with us to the premiere. It was me and my dad's wife and my dad and my aunt, but my aunt, I got pictures of my aunt and I in the limo. And, you know, it's like, this is a big deal to people. You know what I mean? Our family, where we grew up, you know, we grew up going to Hollywood premieres. You know, it's like, I didn't grow up like that. I grew up in a small town in Jersey. So, those are the moments that I think are so incredible when you get to share it with your family and they get to see, you know, what you've been working on. And I think with you and I and other people, it's like, I always think about all the hard work that really went into it. I mean, from the PAs to the, you know, to Mike Metter and Ethan and the crew guys and the lighting guys and the sound and, you know, my hair and makeup team and wardrobe. It's like, these people worked tirelessly, to put this together. And, you know, we get to be up on the screen and we sort of get that recognition of being a part of this, but it's like,
There's a lot of hard work behind it. Really, 100%. I mean, like I said before, going back to 93 was my first open cast call with Night Falls in Manhattan, you know? So we're going from 93 to 2012, all those years in between, you know, all the extra work that we did and there's so much, many, many countless hours that we sacrificed to get there, you know?
That's true.
Sometimes people say, hey, you know, you got it easy. No, I don't think anyone gets it easy. I think we put our time into it, you know?
It doesn't happen easy.
No.
It doesn't. It takes work. It takes a lot of work. And Dave, I mean, without Dave's vision and all the work he put in, I mean, none of us would have made it to that day, you know? So now where are you at? Like what, when you say like, I mean, you still have the deli or just deli done? Are you still?
Deli's done.
Okay.
It's done. I sold it. Yeah. Times were changing, you know, like. In Italian, they say it ain't big ambient. You know, times change.
Yeah.
And my parents got older.
Mm-hmm.
And they were truly the foundation of that store, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I came to the reality, you know, it's hard to admit when you're in a comfort zone for so many years that you no longer can stay in there. So I came to the reality and it was time to move on, you know? Mm-hmm. Not that it made my life easier. It's harder working for someone and, you know, reinventing yourself, and instead of being an owner, you're a dishwasher and you're a grill guy.
Yeah.
You know, you go from being in a movie like Once Upon a Time in Queens and owning your own place and everything is smooth into everything is not, you know. Here I am now, hustling and bustling, not for myself.
Right.
But I always feel like I'm doing it for myself because I feel like, you know, hard work pays off.
I truly believe
in that.
For sure. And what's so great about the deli is that it lives iconically in this film forever.
It does.
You know, it's like most people sell a business and that's it. You might have some pictures of it, but you've got this film.
I do.
I mean, the front of the deli, Michael pulling up to the deli, inside the deli. There's so much. The back room with Paul Ben Victor talking about the cops, and there's so many scenes in there.
I actually have a picture of my dad in the deli, you know?
Oh, it's great. He
passed away last year.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. He passed away. It was tough, but...
very hard.
He ran his race. He tried to teach me as much as he can in this life. You know, basically just told me to be a good person.
Which you are.
Thank you. You know, he told me to be a good person and live your life being a good person. And whatever happens, happens in life. There's nothing we can do, you know?
Right. No, we just don't know. We don't know that story. Now, are you going to try to do any other acting or anything in New York? What's next?
Well, to be quite honest with you, I did a movie not too long ago, and it's coming out in August. And the name of the movie is Deviant in Blue. I play a detective.
It's great.
Different role. It was exciting for me because I love acting. I love doing what I do. Mm-hmm. So you never know. I mean, as far as me, I don't know what's really going to happen next. I'm going to put myself out there, you know?
Good. You should. Know? Yeah.
I am. It's something that I want to do. So I'm going to roll the dice. I actually went to... You know, the Soprano movie's coming out soon.
Yeah, I'm excited to see that.
Yeah. It's going to be a great one. And I actually went for an open cast on that.
Oh, great.
I never got a phone call in return or anything like that, but that's okay. It doesn't stop me.
How you and I were never in the Sopranos is a mystery to me. I mean, we belonged on that show.
I
wasn't in the
Sopranos, though. I actually was a waiter. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. There you go.
I was a waiter inside the Vesuvio restaurant. Vesuvio. For like 3 years.
Yeah, you almost could play relative to the actor that played Artie Bucco.
Artie, yeah. Similar. I worked with him for about a couple of years. I met James Gandolfini and all of them. I worked with them for quite some time. It was incredible.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, that's great.
I learned a lot from those New Jersey guys.
Yeah. And they're all so talented. I'm rewatching the show and I'm listening to they have a podcast called Talking Sopranos, and it's good. Right. It's good behind the scenes
amazing.
Stuff.
They were amazing.
I love it. That's great. Yeah, and what another huge loss, James Gandolfini.
Yeah.
A huge loss, you know. So
it's
crazy, man. You just don't know. Like in a million years, if you would have said to me that we would be talking and Dave wouldn't be here, I would have never believed it. Like I think what you said is true for me too. I feel him. I feel his presence. You know, there's things that he's said to me that I think about, you know what I mean? And I owe him a lot because I would have never been involved if I never met him, you know? So it's crazy how everything comes together. Yeah. And listen, if I ever have a part for you, I would always call you because you were great to work with.
Thank you.
You're a lovely guy.
Thank you.
I appreciate you coming on and doing this. This for me, doing this podcast.
It's great.
Good to
see
you.
Thank you for having me. Really. I mean, listen, you know, life is beautiful, you know, some people say life is short. And some people say life is too long to suffer.
Hmm.
You know, I'm here, you know, and I'm open-minded. I believe in treating people the best that you can, no matter how they are. That's who I am. I live by that code. Treat people good, you know, and good things will happen, you know. And sometimes they don't. Well, but I don't know what I'm getting at right now.
You live your life a certain way. And I'm curious, before we go, I'm curious where that positivity comes from. Were you always this person, always like as a kid? Or
my father.
Did it come? Your father.
My father. Yeah.
He gave it to you.
He always told me, you know, you could do it. If that's what you want to be. Because he would tell me, like, Mario, you know, I want to see you become an actor one day, you know? So I believed in him, you know.
Yeah.
If you know, your dad is your dad. He right. sees something, you know.
Yep.
Yeah. I believe in him, you know, and I live by that today, you know.
And that's, you know, that's what they're here to give us. You know, our right. parents are here to give us those things and that encouragement. But his spirit lives in you, because I saw it in you, and I'm like, yeah.
Right.
Anyway. Well, so good to get to hang out with you a little bit. Thank you for doing this podcast.
You know, this was my first podcast ever. I don't know if it was terrible.
No, you did great.
I don't know the Brooklyn accent. You know, I don't know.
I love it. But I love it.
Maybe I could change it. I could tweak it a little bit. But then it wouldn't be me.
You got to be you. That's it. You keep being you. There's everything. Good things are going to come to you. Just keep being you. And
thank you.
Always. So good to see you, and my love and best to you. And we'll work again. I feel that we'll work again one day together.
Definitely. My love to you and entire family. Congratulations to the newborn baby also. Okay.
Thank you so much.
And I'm so sorry for the loss of your aunt also, really.
Thank you.
You know, no one ever wants to hear that.
No, it's hard. And I'm sorry about your dad, but you know, you know, he's with you. He's always going to be with you.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
All right, sweetheart. Love to all. Good
Thank
to see you.
Peace.
You did great. All right. We'll
Thank
talk
you.
Soon. Bye.
Ciao.